Good morning. We're so glad you're back. It was pretty cold last week, but it's warm enough. We can be outside today, and I always feel better when I'm out here with you and being able to praise the Lord with music and just looking around at this beauty. And a God who can make this much snow is a really big God. So we just want to praise Him today. We're starting the season of Lent. Our candle is in the window, and it's there's several people that have given to that memory today, that hallelujah and that hope. One, I was just thankful for music, our music program, and especially want to, I know Lindrew, he won't stop playing, but he's the one that has really blessed us with his ministry and his leadership through this difficult times. Yeah, you can honk on that. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, he's really been a blessing to us. And for those who are stepping up to help him with our 1035 service here in East Moline. I also want to lift up that Ron and Judy Adams are with that candle. Their daughter Jane is going through cancer treatment, and just wanted to lift her up, and that's a place of hope, and they're so thankful for her life, and we ask for your prayers for their daughter Jane. And then Joanne Hackerson, who has moved away, but her heart is still here with us. Her February 10th would have been her and her husband John's 48th wedding anniversary, and so in memory of him, she asked us to have the hallelujah candle lit here at East Moline. God is with us in the good times. He is with us in the trials of life. He is with us all the way to eternity, and we will be with Him forever. And so we have this time of Lenten to just celebrate His presence with us, and then His invitation for us to draw closer and closer to Him, especially during this season of Lent. You know, Lent to me kind of reminds me of every year as a pastor, you make goals for the year, and then about this time of year, you're reflecting on, well, did you meet your goals, and where do you have to change, what do you need to do to get more of those accomplished? And Lent is like that for me personally, looking at where I am, where I wanted to be, am I in the place that I need to be, and just refocusing, remembering how much I'm loved and my call to be a disciple of His. So come now and worship and give your heart. Come, now is the time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are before your God. Come. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. Now is the time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are before your choose to surrender our lives. Willingly our knees will bow. With all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, we gladly choose you now. Willingly we choose to surrender our lives. Willingly our knees will bow. With all our heart, gladly choose you now. Come, now is the time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Just as you are before your God, come. To God be the glory, great things he hath done. So loved he the world that he gave us his Son, who yielded his life and atonement for sin. Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done. Oh, perfect redemption, the purchase of blood, so every believer the promise of God. The vilest offender who truly believes that moment from Jesus, a pardon. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, things he hath praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high.
I lift your name on high.
Lord, I love to sing your praises.
I love to sing your praises.
I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name. Lord, we do lift up your name today. We praise you. We thank you. We thank you for your willingness to come from the glory of heaven, where all is perfect, all is pure. All that is said about your name is holy and in reverence. And you came into a world that is so fallen, who often speaks your name in disreverence or unbelief, who scorns you, who laughs at you, who would crucify you. And knowing all of that, knowing that that would happen, in complete obedience to the Father's will, you came into our world. And we seek, Lord, to draw close to you, to draw close to the cross, during this season of Lent, to remember who we are because of who you are, and that we are bought, and our adoption into your family is secure because you paid the price for our adoption. You died on the cross that we might be forgiven of our sin, that we would have salvation and our place, a room that you're preparing for us in heaven someday. And for those who are grieving the loss of a loved one, that this season, Lord, this season of the year, be a constant reminder to them that there is hope. That we may be experiencing a winter in our lives right now, but spring is coming, and resurrection hope is with us, and we are an Easter people. Father, we pray for those who need a healing, whether it be physically, emotionally, spiritually, financially, whatever it is, Lord, whatever their needs are, or they might be lifting them up to you right now, their hearts are hurting. Lord, bring in your healing touch. Make your presence real. Answer their prayers in the wisest ways, in your perfect timing. We pray for our country. We pray that the COVID would be erased from the planet Earth. We pray, Father, that in that meantime, that you would teach us the things that we're supposed to learn, and help us, Lord, to be a place of hope as we share a testimony of that you're really real in our lives, and others can come and follow you and find their peace and their hope in your presence in their lives. Father, we lift all this to you, and we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us of our trespasses, and help us to forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning, church. I see all the saints are in the front row this morning. Nobody went up there. Well, I tell you, we are starting a new series today called The Follow Through. And it's, as you know, it's the beginning of the Lenten season. And Jesus had a way of looking at somebody and saying, follow me. Some did. Some didn't. Some began. But when things got tough, they followed him no more. And so as we journey toward the cross this year in the Lenten season, we're going to be looking at the follow-through and applying it to our own lives to see how we are doing when it comes to our follow-through of following Jesus. So today we're going to be talking about come and see and follow me. It comes from John 1, chapter 1, verses 36 through 41. Jesus walked by. When John saw him, he said, look, see God's Lamb. The two followers heard what John had said, so they went after Jesus. Jesus turned. He saw them coming after him. He said to them, what are you looking for? And they said, teacher, where do you live? Jesus said, come and see. And they went and saw the place where Jesus was staying. The time was about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. They stayed with Jesus the rest of the day. Andrew was one of the two followers of John who heard Jesus speak and went after Jesus. He was Simon Peter's brother. The first thing Andrew did then was to find his brother Simon. He said, we have found the Messiah. Messiah means the Christ, the messenger of God. May the Lord add his blessing to the reading and hearing of his holy word. Let's pray. Lord God, speak to us through your holy word, and may this witness to your word be a faithful one. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Well, as we begin a series and also begin the season of Lent, it's appropriate to look at the first followers of Jesus and how that happened, how that came to be. What we see is, right from the beginning, a couple of disciples of John the Baptist. One was Andrew, the brother of Peter, also known as Simon, and he was obviously a follower of John the Baptist. Now, the other one is not mentioned, but remember that we're looking at the Gospel of John, and John, as he wrote his Gospel, wrote it in third person, so he's referring to himself as someone else. And many scholars believe that that second disciple was John himself, the writer of the Gospel. And what's important to notice is that John the Baptist was trying to prepare a way for the Messiah. Now, John the writer, who's different from John the Baptist, he was a disciple of Jesus Christ, and he wrote the fourth gospel, the Gospel of John. And I envision John sitting down with a parchment and a writing utensil and struggling with how to begin this gospel, this writing about the Jesus that he knew. What do I say? How do I describe my experience with Jesus? And then, what inspired me and others to follow him? Those were probably some of the things that he was thinking about. So he puts his pen to parchment, and there he begins with these words from John 1:1. In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God. And the Word was God. Logos. There's something important happening here. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life. And that life was the light of all mankind. And the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. Now, if you study those words, if you really meditate on them and take some time really allowing them to sink in, you will realize that those are some of the greatest words written about Jesus. Some of the greatest descriptions. And then in verse 6, he goes on to explain that there was a man sent by God whose name was John the Baptist, as he's talking about. And he came as a witness to testify concerning the light, that through him all might believe. And then he goes back and he begins to talk about Jesus. And he's talking about us as well. If you were to look at John 1, starting with verse 9, he goes back to the idea of light. Remember, he says the light shines in the darkness and the darkness has not overcome it. The true light, he says, that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. He was in the world. And though the world was not made, and though the world was made through him, the world did not receive him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet, to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision, or a husband's will, but born of God. And then I say all that to get to this personal note that he writes in verse 14. He says, the Word became flesh and made His dwelling among us. We have seen His glory. We have seen His glory, John writes. The glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. He then goes on and talks about John the Baptist and how John the Baptist had to describe who he was, because people were asking, hey, are you the Messiah? And he'd say, no, I'm the one preparing the way. John answered, I baptize people in water, but there is a man standing among you whom you do not know. He is coming after me, and he is greater than I. I am not even good enough to untie his shoestrings. The next day, he's with his disciples. He sees Jesus coming, and he says, look, see God's special Lamb, or behold the Lamb of God, who takes away the wrong ways of the world, or who takes away the sins of the world. Now, that's a description of Jesus saying, look, there's the Lamb of God. And they would know that the Lamb is what is sacrificed for the sins of the nation. John goes on and says, the one who takes away the sins of the world. So that gave him something to think about. The very next day, Jesus walked by again. And this time, John the Baptist is with his two disciples. One of them is Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. The other one, as we said, is probably John, who's writing the story. And he says, look, there he is, the Lamb of God. So at this point, Andrew and John leave John the Baptist. Very much at John the Baptist's agreement. And they start following Jesus. Now imagine, Jesus is walking along and these two guys are following behind him. Finally, Jesus turns around and he says, what are you looking for? He didn't say, what do you want? He said, what are you looking for? Maybe caught by surprise, maybe not knowing what else to say, they call him teacher. They say, teacher, where are you staying? And that comes, and from that comes the first invitation of Jesus. He says, come and see. Come and see. Now, I want to back up and have you remember what was said in John 1, verse 14. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us. We have seen His glory. Jesus says, very first thing, come and see. And so they spend an extended time with Jesus, and then afterward, Andrew goes and finds his brother Peter, Simon Peter, and says, we have seen the Messiah. We have found the Messiah. Now, this is how it starts. At this point, Peter gets interested. Other people get interested. And they begin to look at Jesus and ask himself, is he the one? Is he the one who is anointed by God to be the Christ? The one from God who would save us. Is he the one? Now, the question that is important for us to see in this text that we looked at is that there are several ways of looking at Jesus. First is what John the Baptist says, which is pretty powerful. He says, look, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. He's the one that is going to be the sacrifice to take away the sins of the world. He is the one. Now, the disciples, they're not sure yet. They follow him. And when he does, when they do have a chance to interact with him, remember what they call him? Teacher. Right at the beginning, they say teacher. And then when Andrew has a chance to explain to Peter what he found out about Jesus, the only thing he can say is, we have found the Messiah. This guy is the Christ. Now, that begins a series of follow me's. In the very next, in verse 43 of John 1, it says, the next day Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, follow me. We know that in Galilee he was calling disciples. He called many of them. He called Simon Peter and had to actually interact with Peter about three times. Peter said, depart from me, for I am a sinful man. And Jesus' response was, follow me and I will make you fishers of men. Time and time again. And then finally, the 12 were ready to follow. So why would they follow? But even more of a question is, why should we follow? And I guess if I wanted to get really honest and introspective, I would ask, why should I follow? During this Lenten season, we're going to be looking at that whole concept of following Jesus. Not just following him, but follow through. Wherever it takes us to allow Jesus to lead us on the way. It's important, you know, because there are many different voices in the world today. There are different philosophies. There's different shouts from society saying, do this, do that, follow this. But it takes me back to a time when I was working on my Doctor of Ministry degree, and I intentionally wanted to study under a man by the name of Dr. Robert Tuttle. And the reason I wanted to is because this man had an incredible heart and passion for evangelism, of leading people to Christ, and written several books about it. But he did his doctoral work on the founder of the Methodist Church, John Wesley. And I don't know of anybody who took it more seriously than Dr. Tuttle. He moved to London to stay close to where John Wesley was in school and where he lived. He spent his time reading every possible bit of writing that John Wesley had ever written, and he wrote extensively. This man was so saturated by John Wesley that he ended up writing a book that has been used by many seminaries to study John Wesley. And part of the book, as he's written, he quotes John Wesley, but then he actually, in his own words, writes it as if John Wesley is writing it. He knew the man that well. And so when I was with Dr. Tuttle, I got one of his books. And I asked, I said, Dr. Tuttle, will you sign this for me? He said, well, sure. And so he signed it, closed it up, gave it to me. Later on, I opened it up. And he wrote to Roger, May we follow John Wesley only so far as he follows Jesus Christ and no further. Folks, that's stuck with me. Because when we choose what church to be at, when we choose what pastor to listen to, when we choose what leaders to follow, remember that as a disciple of Jesus Christ, as a Christ follower, we follow somebody only so far as they follow Jesus Christ and no further. Now we'll see how this plays out as Jesus goes on through his ministry. And I think you'll be surprised at how many times and how many different ways he extended the opportunity for people to follow him. But for right now, I want you to ask these questions to yourself. Number one, why would Andrew and John and Peter and Philip and the others follow Jesus? And then why should all of us follow Jesus? And then finally, get honest. And as you begin this Lenten season, ask yourself, why should I follow Jesus? And what does that truly look like? Let's pray. Lord God, as we look at following through with you, being your followers, I ask that you encourage us to do that which you are calling us to do, and that we follow you first and foremost, and that we follow other people only so far as they follow you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the grave to the sky, Lord, we lift your name on high. Go now and share your faith with someone who needs love, hope, forgiveness. Point them toward God. Let him save them as he is saving you. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and all God's people. You got it. Have a great week.